Welcome to worship with St. Andrew's United Church, Markham. As we always do at the beginning of our worship time together, we acknowledge the land on which we live and work and worship. And here in Canmore, I live on the traditional territory of the Yarhe Nakota people, Bearspaw, Chiniki, and Wesley nations. And they are signatories to Treaty 7 in southern Alberta. And we also acknowledge other nations, including the Métis Nation of Alberta, Region 3.
In Markham, we acknowledge that we walk and meet for worship upon the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee and the Anishinaabe peoples. We also acknowledge that in Markham, we are on treaty lands of the Williams Treaty. We are all treaty people, and we seek to be on a path of reconciliation with all our treaty partners. Good morning and welcome to everyone here this morning. As we gather as a community of faith, let us remember that St. Andrew's United Church has a mission and a vision. At St. Andrew's United Church, our mission includes inspiring faith, practicing compassion, and building connection in our community and the world. And we have a vision to be creative and courageous people, empowered by the Spirit, to practice love, reconciliation, and justice with authenticity, to be a spiritual home where Jesus' love for all is visible as we serve our diverse and multi-generational community. As we continue our worship through the season of Epiphany, we remember that Epiphany is the season in which we remember that the light of Christ shows us even more than we knew before of the light of God's love, the way forward in our paths of faith to help us to grow and to learn of the love of God in all our lives. I'm going to invite you to receive the peace of Christ and to pass it on to others. The peace of Christ be with you.
Great to see waves and namastes with all of us that are joined together, 53 sign-ins as of right now. I do want to highlight just a couple of announcements that are in your bulletin, and I want to talk about an announcement that I forgot to put in. So there are two regions who are doing a joint online confirmation process. So if you have teenagers in your house, or if you have teenagers that you know about who are part of the congregation, or who you think might be interested in having faith conversations, there is a youth confirmation process. It is in the bulletin. Also, we want to highlight that Yvonne is putting together January's newsletter. The deadline for submissions is tomorrow. So please be in touch with Yvonne to add your submission. The announcement that didn't make it into the bulletin is that the transition team is planning to run another congregational event next Sunday. So we're back to Zoom congregational events to help move our intentional interim process along. And what we're working with next week is we're examining our core values, what lies at the core of the St. Andrew's identity. We're going to explore this by spending time with what we say about ourselves as a congregation, what we're communicating to the world and our neighborhood and ourselves by how we introduce ourselves at the beginning of worship and on the front page of our website. So please be prepared to come and have lively conversation with one another in Zoom breakout rooms. And please plan to be in the Zoom worship longer than usual, because we have the freedom on Zoom to be able to have conversations. So from 10 until 11:30 next week. I'm going to invite you to enter into prayer with me, with our prayer of approach. In you, O Lord our God, we find our joy. For through your law and your prophets, you formed a people in mercy and freedom, in justice and righteousness. Pour your spirit on us today, that we who are Christ's body may bear the good news of your ancient promises to all who seek you. Amen. And let's join our voices together, even though we're muted, with Michael as we sing verses 1 and 2 of hymn number 603, In Loving Partnership We Come.
Come to God.
Sorry, you were muted. You were...
Thank you. Unmute myself. Let us come together in prayer as we bring our confessions and our honest understanding of who we are in God. Let us pray. Source of love and forgiveness, you wrap us in constant compassion, inviting us to journey toward a way of wholeness. We confess that we can become weary, O God, with trying to do the right thing. The measures that we need to take in order to protect others and ourselves in this time and place have taken their toll on our enthusiasm, on our ability to support one another. We confess that we wish for things to be completely different, even as we miss the sight of how much good we are doing right now. Hear these confessions we bring to you, O God, as well as the many more that we lift only in the silence of our hearts. Hear now our silent confessions. hear the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. As we wait upon the Lord, we are renewed. We shall run and not be weary. We shall walk and not faint. Thanks be to God. For our time together this morning with children of all ages, I'm going to invite you to listen to one of Aesop's fables. For any of the younger folks here this morning who haven't heard the name Aesop before, Aesop was someone who lived a long time ago, even before the birth of Christ. He was a Greek storyteller. And the special thing about Aesop's fables, which I've got in this book here, is that every one of them is an effort in some ways to help us to remember something of value, something that can be helpful in our lives as we try to grow and to learn. The story that I'm going to invite you to hear this morning is called The Monkey and the Camel. And the first picture that goes along with it has a whole number of animals. And if you can see on your screen, if you're not on your phone, you can see all kinds of animals. I'm hoping that you can see the camel way in the background, the donkey in the foreground, and the rooster and the horse. The cow is in the corner, and of course, the monkey who we're going to be hearing about in the story. A camel was once much admired by the other animals because he was such a hard worker. He hauled water, pulled heavy loads, and was always willing to carry his friends on his great hump. The animals rewarded him with clean, soft straw on which to lie and tender grass to eat. Then one day, a monkey appeared and started doing funny tricks. Soon, all the animals gathered around, clapping and laughing. "Hee-haw, hee-haw," brayed the donkey. Let's look at the picture on the next page. "Look at that clever monkey swinging by his tail from the palm tree and turning somersaults," mooed the cow. "And dancing and leaping in the air," neighed the horse. When the monkey finally sat down to rest, everyone cheered and rewarded him with fat bananas, sweet grapes, and sugar lumps. They had him relax on a silk cushion. Only the camel was not impressed. "What's so funny about that silly monkey?" he grumbled. "His tricks aren't so special." "Indeed," bellowed the cow. "Then let's see what you can do." So the camel tried to swing by his tail from the palm tree, but flopped right back in the mud. And that's the last picture that we see on our picture. When he tried to turn a somersault, his hump got in the way. When he tried to dance, he stumbled over his own big feet. The animals were sad to see the camel make such a fool of himself. "I'd rather watch the monkey," said the rooster. And they all agreed. And if we were to think about that story for a bit, we might even know for ourselves what it is that the story might be trying to tell us about the camel who tried to entertain and make people watch him by doing what only the monkey was able to do very well. The moral of the story, we are told, is be yourself. I'm going to invite you all to sing another time this month of January, the new hymn, Draw the Circle Wide. And as you were, I believe, trying to do last week, this is one of those hymns that is very easy to use our whole selves, not just our voices, but some actions that go along with this song. And the actions that you are invited to use make a whole lot of sense with the words, draw the circle wide, draw it wider still. You can make a bigger circle the second time. Let this be our song. No one stands alone, standing side by side. Draw the circle wide. Let's sing verses 1 and 3.
I'm just going to play.
In the Gospel of Luke, we have so far been hearing stories about what we know of Jesus before he began his mission of preaching and teaching and healing among the people of his day. The passage that we hear this morning is the very first story in Luke's Gospel of Jesus being out amongst the people of his time and place, first in places in Galilee, and then in this story, he came back to his hometown, the place where he grew up, of Nazareth. We find him being received very warmly at first by the people of Nazareth, but things take a different turn as he continues to encourage them to learn and to grow of his place and his purpose in the world. Let us hear as Beth reads for us from Luke.
Good morning. I'm reading from the Revised Standard Version. Then Jesus, filled with the power of the Spirit, returned to Galilee, and a report about him spread through all the surrounding country. He began to teach in their synagogues and was praised by everyone. When he came to Nazareth, where he had been brought up, he went to the synagogue on the Sabbath day, as was his custom. He stood up to read, and the scroll of the prophet Isaiah was given to him. He unrolled the scroll and found the place where it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. And he rolled up the scroll, gave it back to the attendant, and sat down. The eyes of all the synagogue were fixed on him. Then he began to say to them, "Today this scripture has been fulfilled in your hearing." All spoke well of him and were amazed at the gracious words that came from his mouth. They said, Is not this Joseph's son? He said to them, "Doubtless you will quote to me this proverb, 'Doctor, cure yourself,' and you will say, 'Do here also in your hometown the things that we have heard you did at Capernaum.'" And he said, "Truly, I tell you, no prophet is accepted in the prophet's hometown. But the truth is, there were many widows in Israel in the time of Elijah, when the heaven was shut up 3 years and six months. And there was a severe famine over all the land. Yet Elijah was sent to none of them except to a widow at Zarephath in Sidon. There were also many lepers in Israel in the time of the prophet Elisha, and none of them was cleansed except Naaman the Syrian." When they heard this, all in the synagogue were filled with rage. They got up, drove him out of town, and led him to the brow of the hill on which their town was built, so that they might hurl him off the cliff. But he passed through the midst of them and went on his way. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you very much, Beth. Let us come together in prayer. Let us pray. Help us, O God, to hear your word in us through the stories of your son's work and mission in the world. And may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. I would like to introduce you to someone who I met when I was a student resident many years ago. I spent 3 years in student residence during my undergraduate years in university. And in the third year that I was there, someone joined us in residence by the name of Norm Kuntz. I met Norm Kuntz and got to know him quite well that year. And what I would want you to know about Norm was that he was a very thoughtful and deep thinker. He enjoyed engaging in conversation and in debate about a whole range of topics. He was also very smart, very quick, and he often was able to think of one-liners to add to the humor and to the levity of conversations that we would have in the common room at student residence. He also loved to sail boats. And on the summer after I first met him, he was looking for someone in student residence to join him at his cottage for as much of the summer as they could in order to help him, because his sailboat was a two-person sailboat, an albacore. And so while he was the skipper and he was in charge of whatever the boat was doing, he needed somebody else to man the jib and do other things while he was racing his sailboat on the lake his cottage was on. But there's one more thing which I want to tell you about Norm, and I purposefully left it to the end because if you were to meet Norm in person, it's probably the first thing that you would see, and it is probably the thing which might make you take a long time to realize all of these other things that I was telling you about Norm, and that is that Norm has cerebral palsy. For those of you who know, have a friend or a relative or someone in your circle with cerebral palsy, you know exactly what it is I am talking about. For those of you who don't, cerebral palsy is an injury that happens at birth, very rarely, but it is something that affects your motor skills and your ability to walk and talk and in many ways, all kinds of other things. For those with a very severe palsy, they need to stay in a wheelchair. In Norm's case, he was fortunate to be able to walk with a very awkward gait, but his speech was always slurred as if he was drunk. Whenever he thought of a quick wit to throw into the conversation, he always explained that he was never really good at being the joker or the funny person because it would take him a second or two longer to actually get his brilliant insight or his one-liner out into the conversation. So he admitted that as much as he has a good sense of humor, he was not really the funny person in the room. Knowing Norm and the way that we got to know him over the years it was quite remarkable because we knew that who he was as a person and as a member of society was not determined by a illness or a disease, a condition that he had, the condition of cerebral palsy. He was rather someone who was caring and compassionate and wanting to make a difference in the world. And at the time that I knew him, in his first year at university, he was in the middle of writing a book. The book was called Ready, Willing, and Disabled. And it was ultimately a book that was potentially going to be helpful for teachers in the educational system and in the schools to help to integrate people with special needs into regular classrooms, because at the time that he started school, there was no opportunity for him to attend a school unless it was a special school, a special needs school. But as he came to the end of his elementary school years, he wanted nothing more than to attend a regular high school. And as much as he knew that it was going to be a challenge, he thought it could be done. And he was ready to do everything that he needed to make it succeed, to make it work. And through his years through high school, with patient helpers and guides and teachers and education officials, he, in fact, did graduate from high school in the very unusual circumstances. And this was the motivation for him to write a book about his experience and how things can be done to integrate someone of at least his special needs into a regular high school without keeping them separate, keeping them apart, where everyone was being catered to with even more severe needs than him. Norm was learning. He was getting to know what it is that he had learned and could share with others. And at the time that he was writing the book, he was asking for a lot of help and a lot of assistance from his friends and fellow students in residence into how he could put his thoughts down on paper in the most effective way, in the most persuasive way, in the way which would enable teachers, the readers of his book, to want to do the difficult work of becoming, helping many to integrate. The reason I'm telling this story is because after I graduated, I didn't have that much opportunity to get together and to renew our friendship with Norm, but we did have one chance about 8 years later when I was already a minister in the London area by that time, and Norm gave me a call one day because he was going to be in the London area. He was going to be speaking at Althaus College in London, the teachers' college there. And he was interested in getting together and getting caught up on what we had all both been doing. I had become ordained and was now a minister. He had become a speaker and a presenter of the kind of material that he was trying to develop in his university days and with the book that he had written, Ready, Willing, and Disabled. It was wonderful getting together with Norm again, and it was wonderful going to his presentation at Althaus College and hearing him speak to the people, to student teachers and others who came to hear him speaking. But the thing that I noticed more than anything else is that what Norm was saying now was not the way he talked, the way he questioned, the way he was worried and uncertain in university. He now gave his ideas with clarity and with confidence and with hope that as we work together, we could become a community that integrates people of all abilities and needs in our society. That he had come to understand his work and his mission not so much as helping a small number of people in our society, but helping society as a whole become richer and become more fully integrated as we learn and help one another. Norm, in my eyes, had become an authority on how to become better as a society as we try to learn from those with special needs, and as we try to help them to become as active and as fully integrated as possible in the society of others. He was no longer just hoping, he was participating in the very ideals and the goals in which he was engaged. In the Gospel of Luke, we hear the story that Luke tells us of the beginning of Jesus' ministry. And we hear that after he was led back out of the wilderness by the Spirit, the wilderness, the place where Jesus went to wrestle with the things that he had already learned and what he still needed to learn in order to become more effective in the work that he had been given, Jesus began speaking and teaching and being received with tremendous hope and with tremendous warmth by the people of Galilee. By the time he came back to his hometown of Nazareth, he had already gained a reputation. The people of his hometown heard about this fellow who they saw grow up, from ever since he was knee-high to a grasshopper, they heard of the wonderful things he was doing and the tremendous accomplishments he was able to succeed in with others as he brought them the light of God's love, as he brought them healing to their physical being, as he brought them acceptance and welcome into society in ways that they had not realized that they could be a part of the community before. And so when the people of his hometown saw him arrive, they were very hopeful that they could understand fully how this person who had grown up in their midst and with their guidance could be such a wonderful teacher and worker in God's world. And the first thing that we hear in the Gospel of Luke of Jesus' return to his hometown is that Jesus had a very clear understanding of who he was. When the book of the prophet Isaiah was given to him in the synagogue, he found the place in which it was said, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, because he has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, to let the oppressed go free, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." And I can only imagine that by this time in his life, Jesus had grown into a person who not only realized how wonderful the word would be if there was release to the captives, sight to the blind, the oppressed were able to go free, but he realized that he could play a part. He could be a person who enabled those things to actually take place. And the people of his hometown, who had seen him grow up through times of questioning and frivolous play while he was younger, realized that this sense of who he was, his statement of his mission in the world, was not just a pipe dream, was not just something that he was trying to work out in the best way possible, but it was something that had become his core, the way in which he thought of himself in the world. And he was ready to speak about this mission with the whole world, with all those who would listen. Just as we are encouraged in our own life in God's world, to know who we are, to know what our mission is, to know what we are living into and the part that we can play in God's world. One of the questions that I am going to ask you a couple of times during our time of reflection this morning is, what is it that makes St. Andrew's United Church in Markham special? What is it that makes us who we are? And I know that all of us in this community of faith have different ways of answering that question. We look back to the time when we first came to St. Andrew's, and we have some sense deep inside as to what was good, the ways in which we benefited about that, and the reasons why we continue to come together. But this morning, I'm going to invite you to do not only answer that question for ourselves in ways that we often don't put into words, but ask ourselves what it means to speak the same words together as a community of faith. And the words that we use during our welcome every Sunday morning worship is that at St. Andrew's United Church, our mission includes, our mission as broad and as big as it is and might go beyond these words, it for certain includes inspiring faith, practicing compassion, and building connection in our community and the world. Inspiring faith, practicing compassion, and building connection in our community and the world. And if you could imagine for a moment, what would it take for us to tell the world, or even just to tell Markham, that that is our mission in a way that makes them sit up and take notice, to realize that we are not just putting a pipe dream into words, but that we are actually determined? What would it take for them to hear some voice of authority in ourselves as we speak those words? The people of Jesus' hometown, the people who thought they knew Jesus better than anybody else, saw something different, something new, as he spoke the words of the prophet Elijah in their mix. They realized that he was determined that these were not just going to be words spoken by a prophet of generations past, but that he was going to put himself in the middle of God's work to bring release to the captives, sight to the blind, recovery to those who most needed it. The gospel passage from Luke helps us to remember very strongly that Jesus, through his growth and development from birth, and especially through his time in the wilderness after his baptism, had become deeply rooted in his sense of who he was. But he also ran into the obstacles of who other people thought he was. The people of his hometown thought they knew him, thought they had seen him grow up, thought they could figure out exactly what it is that made him say the things that he was saying and do the things that he was doing. And for Jesus, he seemed to know and tried to tell the people that how they saw him could become an obstacle. Not only could it become an obstacle, but that is in fact what it actually turned out to be. As the people looked on him with wonder at his sense of authority and the difference that he could make in God's world, he said to them, "You realize that I'm not going to be able to give you the same kind of blessing that I have given to others who don't already have blinders on. Your blinders are that you think you know me so well. You think you know everything about me. You think that you know what I'm capable of and what I'm not capable of. You want to see me impress you the way that others have impressed you, but despite the fact that you are special for having seen me grow up, your sense of being special might become an obstacle, might become a hindrance to you being fully open to the wonder and the blessings that I can offer to you now. As I continue to ask you this morning, and as you are invited to hear throughout the coming time of transition in St. Andrew's United Church, we are invited to think about what it is that we can become as we seek to learn more of our mission to inspire faith, to practice compassion, and to build connection in our community and the world. We might hear those words as we've heard them so many times before and say, oh, I know what that means. I know exactly how we have been doing that and how we should be doing that. If we do not use the opportunity in some ways to come to that, those words of mission with a new sense of hopefulness and of openness, we may, as Jesus found in his hometown, think that we already know what to expect, think that we already know everything that we should be capable of. One more story of Norm Kuntz, something that I found out years later when we were getting caught up on where what we had been doing in each other. I found out that Norm was starting to hear back in the 1990s of experimental procedures that were being done with people who have cerebral palsies. And they were potentially procedures that might help a person with that condition improve or perhaps even be able to overcome completely the conditions that they have had since birth. And as Norm talked to me about this dream, this idea that surgical procedures might be able to correct or perhaps even lessen the effects of his cerebral palsy, he realized that the question about whether or not he would want to participate in those kinds of procedures went much deeper than simply, does he want to fix something? Is there something wrong that he thinks can be put behind him or fixed? He realized that from the beginning of his awareness in life, he was someone with cerebral palsy who has saw the world through a different eyes and was able to bless the world with his knowledge, with his background, with his experience in ways that he wouldn't have been able to without his daily constant struggle with the need for integration, the need for mutual respect and hopefulness in society. And as he confessed to me, he said, even if it was possible that these experimental procedures might become very successful, he realized that he had come to the point where he could not change something so integral, so much at the core of his self to take it away from his experience of life at all. What would it take for us to say that what makes St. Andrew's United Church in Markham special is a sense of mission that cannot be taken away, a sense of mission which we can come together and explore and to look at more deeply so that it makes a difference in our daily lives, in the way that we talk to our companions, our friends, our relatives, and to the community in which we live. What would it take to make us special in that sense of mission in the world? Thanks be to God. Let us come together in prayer. Help us, O God, to hear what you said to the people of the home, your hometown when Jesus visited Nazareth. Help us to have the kind of sense of mission that he had as he tried to get those who thought they knew him to see more, to see something greater, to see something deeper in his place in your world. Through Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Thank you, Tim, for your words this morning. This is the time in our service where we take some time to say thank you. I want to take a little bit more time. St. Andrew's is really good at stepping up. We have seen how you stepped up so dramatically in December with your gifts, your financial gifts. And today I'd like to talk a little bit more about that. You know, when we say sharing of time, talents, and treasure, the sharing of talents and what Tim has talked about today, about really living into our mission. And I mentioned last week with from out of chapter 12 in 1 Corinthians, we were reminded that we all have really essential gifts to contribute to the well-being of the body of Christ. Well, we're starting a time, a phase in the interim work where we are adjusting the organization. And our structure needs to change as a body, just as our bodies change as we grow older or as we are born and grow through different phases. And so as a growing and changing organization, we are needing team players who are willing to step up and help direct the changes that are going on right now that will become more solid and we hope will be in good solid, will be solidly built by the time your new minister is called. Now, very often we don't necessarily see our own gifts as clearly as we see the gifts of others. And so I want you to be thinking about other great team players who you've seen at work at, in the past at St. Andrew's and the helpers who have been reliable workers, maybe in the background, or people you've been with in a group that you can see would be a great team player to be a part of this evolving, emerging new structure. And we're asking you specifically to consider others. So who are those folks? And if you would let Michelle know in the announcement about new leadership in the bulletin, she has given her email address, please bring those names forward to Michelle and we will talk with those folks and discern how they might best serve. This is an ongoing process, but right now we are needing folks to join Bivolino. Thank you so much, Bee, to who has said yes to starting the new M&P team. We are needing a treasurer, and we are needing someone who is already maybe a part of the building team or someone who would be willing to come onto the building, the team that works with the building, who would be accountable, like be willing to report to the council. So as we live out our mission, thank you for what you already contribute. Thank you to all those who have been giving of their talents over low these many years. And how can we continue to build excitement, as Tim has mentioned, about living into our mission together? And someone who regularly gives of his gifts and talents, we turn now to Rick, who is going to, we're going to sing. First of all, we're going to dedicate those gifts, and then we're going to move into Rick singing for us. And so our hymn of dedication, As of Gladness, Men of Old, verse 3.
Thank you.
did jump the gun there. So thank you in advance, Rick, for your willingness to step up on a regular basis and share your gifts of music.
Thank you, Shannon. Good morning, everybody. We have Kathy on the violin this morning. This song is all about shine, Jesus, shine.
Thank you very much, Rick, and thank you, Kathy, and thank you for putting us in the light of the sunshine through your window in the house, along with the music. Let us come together in prayer now as we lift to God all the prayers in our hearts. Let us pray. We thank you, compassionate God, that you hear the prayers of our hearts. You hear our times of celebration when we bring to you our gratitude and thanksgiving. You hear the times of our longing and yearning when we ask for your help, when we ask for you to hear the needs of ourselves and others. Whenever we rejoice at a baby's new birth, whenever we are grateful for our work meeting with success, whenever we are surrounded by the love of family and friends, we give you praise and joy, O God. We come to you with our prayers for those who mourn when the circle is incomplete, when a friend or loved one has died, for all who suffer because no work is to be found, for all who are bored, not having enough to do, for all who are tired, having too much to do, for all who are unsure as to what this time in pandemic is going to do in the core of their being as they yearn to gather and to celebrate with others in the ways that they have truly enjoyed. Help us, O God, to support one another always, rejoicing with those who rejoice, weeping with those who weep. We want to be joined together as members of the body of Christ. Hear now as we join in the prayer that your Son taught us, as we say together, Our Mother, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. As we are led by Michael, let us join in singing 589 in Voices United, verses 1 and 2. Lord, speak to me that I may speak.
Hour of every day, go now in faith.
go forth into the world with a daring love. Go in peace. The world is waiting. And whatever you do, do it for love and in the spirit of Jesus, who is your Christ. Amen.